Hello everyone. Let's take a look at important keywords which have come up in today's newspaper for 13th May 2020. So starting with it, first you have the news that India is going to chair World Health Assembly of World Health Organization. So whose important decision-making, topmost executive body, the decision-making body is World Health Assembly, and India is going to chair it. So that is the news. And presently there is an issue about Taiwan. Taiwan is also known as Chinese Taipei, as we've seen many sports events, international sport events too. So China opposes Taiwan's admission to World Health Organization, and World Health Assembly will be taking the decision. USA insists on Taiwan be included. China insists Taiwan should not be included. And India is the chair, so it will be taking this decision. And it's in a dilemma. Then next is IIP at -16.7% in March 2020. So in index of industrial production has contracted drastically. It has gone in the negative at -16.7%. And this is March 2020 data, means this is from the time the lockdown started, was from 25th March. So looking at it, the data for April is going to be frightening. The next is IDSA, that is Institute for Defense Studies and Analysis, has been renamed as Manohar Parrikar Institute for Defense Studies and Analysis after late former Defense Minister Manohar Parrikar. This has created furor because IDSA members say that they had not been consulted on this before the name change. They say that we do not refute a contribution of former Defense Minister Manohar Parrikar, but renaming it after a politician would politicize the defense organization, which should not happen. The next is Museum on Prime Ministers of India. So Prime Minister Narendra Modi had laid the foundation stone earlier for the Museum on Prime Ministers of India, which will be at the Nehru Memorial premises. So the Teen Murti complex, which was the residence of the first Prime Minister of the country, Jawaharlal Nehru, houses the museum of on Jawaharlal Nehru. It's Jawaharlal Nehru Museum, but the Prime Minister said that it should be a museum for all Prime Ministers. So Central Public Works Department has initiated the tendering process for this initiative. And next is Italian hydropower project. This is 3097 megawatt hydropower project proposed in Arunachal Pradesh, but it has been deferred again by the Forest Advisory Committee of the Environment Ministry. It has been deferred for 6 years because it is going to result in cutting down of lakhs of trees in the biodiverse Dihang Valley of Arunachal Pradesh. So again, it has been deferred. Then next is regarding phases of clinical trials. So these are clinical trials being conducted by Glenmark Pharmaceutical Company of India for a drug, antiviral drug for treating COVID-19. And for this, phase 3 trial has been initiated. But what is important for us is different phases of clinical trials. What are they? What is phase 1? What is phase 2? And then phase 3, and even there's phase 4. So we'll discuss that in detail. And lastly, you have news regarding GI tag being accorded, that is geographical indication tag being accorded to two products. One is Sohrai Khovar painting, which is of Jharkhand, which is also found at important places, public places in Jharkhand presently, like even at the Birsa Munda International Airport of Jharkhand has Sohrai Khovar paintings. It has been accorded GI tag. And Telai Rumal of Telangana. So these are on handlooms. They have to be done with hands. It cannot be done on machines, otherwise they lose their quality. So these Telai Rumals of Telangana have also been accorded GI tag. So we'll look at them in detail too. So let's start with it. These are the important headlines which have been picked up from the Hindu newspaper. We'll look at them in detail. The first one, PM announces rupees 20 lakh crore economic stimulus package. So Prime Minister Narendra Modi on 12th May announced a new look lockdown 4.0, which will go beyond May 17. And he also announced an economic stimulus package for 20 lakh crores. So this is estimated at 10% of the GDP. So he also said the country should become Atmanirbhar, means self-reliant. So he called for Atmanirbhar Bharat. And this amount which is announced, 20 lakh crore, it includes packages which have already been announced at the beginning of the lockdown and the measures which have been announced by RBI and the payouts under the Pradhan Mantri Garib Kalyan Yojana. So all these are included in this package which has been announced. So it adds up to 20 lakh crore. Also, he says self-reliance is important. He says it does not mean that we become insular, with you know that we are not open to outside world, we should not be insular and suspicious, but embrace the world in the spirit of Vasudev Kutumb. So he says that self-reliance like was required in the country, like in the present scenario, present crisis too, we saw that we did not have PPE kits and N95 masks manufactured in India. But then when the crisis emerged, we have developed this potential too. So he called for such self-reliant India. He said this self-reliant India should be based on five pillars of economy, infrastructure, demography, technologically driven systems, and strengthening of demand and supply chains. And in this also he emphasized on buying local and being vocal about it. So how in the present lockdown it was the local shops which helped in providing supplies. So he emphasized on local supply chains too. And the details of this 20 lakh crore package as such is expected to be announced by Nirmala Sitharaman, finance minister, soon. Then next is Arogya Setu app mandatory for returning NRIs migrants. So expanding the ambit of Arogya Setu app now, Union Health Ministry has directed downloading it will be compulsory for all returnees, migrant laborers and those coming from abroad. So this will help in better contact surveillance and suitable medical intervention. Health Ministry has also asked states to ramp up surveillance of SARI and ILI, that is severe acute respiratory infections and influenza-like illnesses, to detect any possible hidden infection at an early stage to ensure timely containment. So this, as you can see, how in India new fatalities are increasing. This is the average number of COVID-19 deaths globally, and the fatalities are also increasing in the country is shown. Is symmetry in Brazil. The next is India caught in US-China spat over Taiwan status as World Health Organization. So we saw how India is going to take over as next chairperson of World Health Organization's decision-making executive body in May 2020, and here it will be faced with a major choice on whether to support US to reinstate Taiwan's observer status at World Health Organization or China's opposition to it. So there has been a worldwide debate on World Health Organization's role as such too during the pandemic. The organization has been criticized, even the WHO Director General has been criticized for not taking effective action at early stage. So this is regarding World Health Assembly, the supreme governing body of WHO, World Health Organization. It meets annually, generally in the month of May, in Geneva, the headquarters in Switzerland. So the main functions of the assembly are to determine international health policy and program, review the work of past year, approve the budget, and elect member states to designate a person to serve for 3 years on executive board. So that has been done. It has an executive board where members are elected for 3 years. So various countries send their members. The next is no airspace violation at Pangong So. So this is Pangong So Lake in eastern Ladakh. And here we had seen recently a tiff between Indian and Chinese forces, and it was seen that helicopters from China's People's Liberation Army were coming close to the LAC, but then it has been stated by Indian Air Force that there has been no airspace violation. There is an agreement on maintenance of peace and tranquility across the LAC in India-China border area of 1996, which says that such combat aircraft helicopters shall not fly within 10 kilometers of LAC. And the Indian Air Force claims that no violation has taken place. Local level interaction and dialogue disengaged the conflict. Then next is industrial output shrank 16.7% in March. So IIP, Index of Industrial Production, in March 2020 has contracted. Means it is growth is minus 16.7%. And this is after for the entire month of March, while the lockdown began on 25th March. So the data for April would be worse, as should be expected. So before March, in February, we had a positive growth of 4.5% in IIP, and then it took a dip. Even before February, you can see here, the data shows it was December, Jan and Feb that it was in the positive, November, December. In October, you can see again it was in the negative at minus 6.6%. And right now it has gone to minus 16.7%. And within IIP, the three major sectors are manufacturing, electricity generation, and mining. So manufacturing sector was in the negative at -20% for March, electricity generation at -7%, while mining remained flat without any growth or contraction significantly. So this is there. And within the manufacturing sector too, the worst effect has been on the automobile sector, which declined 50%. Next comes computer and electronic products, which fell almost 42%. So this is index of industrial production for March 2020. And here you can see mining, manufacturing, and electricity are also shown. Even we have earlier run eight core sectors also included within IIP. They are responsible for 40% of IIP. So eight core sectors, growth, that data had come earlier, and now this is for the entire IIP. Then next is, do numbers matter in Rajya Sabha? So this is in the context of the Rajya Sabha, which is the upper house of parliament, and how the Lok Sabha and Rajya Sabha differ and are same too, because in general, in case of ordinary bill, Lok Sabha and Rajya Sabha have same powers, but for money bill or finance bill, Lok Sabha has more powers. So these bills can be introduced only in Lok Sabha, and also if Rajya Sabha rejects them, then too Lok Sabha can pass them. So Rajya Sabha has minimal powers. At the most, it can stall this bill because it has time of 14 days to look into the bill. So it can stall the bill for 14 days. Otherwise, it does not have any significant powers with respect to money bill or finance bill. But Rajya Sabha has its own special powers, like for adopting a resolution allowing parliament to legislate on a subject in the state list. So because Rajya Sabha, the English name is also House of States, Council of States. So Council of States means it has membership, indirect elections from state legislators. So that is why it is a state's representative at the center. So to legislate on any subject in the state list, resolution has to be adopted in Rajya Sabha. Then only parliament can legislate on state list subject. Then second special power of Rajya Sabha is creating All India Services. That is also in the hands of Rajya Sabha. It initiates there. Also proclamation of emergency and president's rule when the Lok Sabha is dissolved is in the hands of Rajya Sabha. So then it also talks about how since the first general election in 1952, government which has been in power, means which the party which has majority in Lok Sabha also had majority in Rajya Sabha. But this continued only for 29 years, and and later for 39 years it was in minority. And at an unbroken stretch for the last 31 years, government which is in power in Lok Sabha is a minority in Rajya Sabha. So then there are allegations made that Rajya Sabha is an obstructionist body. But then that is not the case, has been proved in this study, which has been undertaken by Rajya Sabha Secretariat. It says joint sittings are also possible of Lok Sabha and Rajya Sabha when there are differences. So there have been so far only three joint sittings to resolve differences between Lok Sabha and Rajya Sabha. First one was in 1961, when then Nehru government enjoyed majority in Rajya Sabha, but Dowry Prohibition Bill suffered a defeat. Then second time was during Banking Service Commission Repeal Bill, which was rejected by Rajya Sabha. And third one was Prevention of Terrorism Bill, which was not passed by Rajya Sabha. So these three cases, when Rajya Sabha did not pass the bills, joint sittings were held. And in joint sittings, while Lok Sabha has the majority, has the numbers, so it is easier to pass bills in joint sittings. So present government also, it is said, does not have the numbers in Rajya Sabha, but important legislations have been passed by Rajya Sabha supporting the government, like landmark legislations relating to GST, Insolvency and Bankruptcy Code, Triple Talaq, Unlawful Activities Act, Reorganization of Jammu and Kashmir, Citizenship Amendment Act, and so on. So they all have been passed by Rajya Sabha. So Rajya Sabha cannot be called obstructionist. Also, productivity of Rajya Sabha had been 100% till 1997, but later it has reduced, means number of bills being passed. But it is said it is becoming more and more of a deliberative body, spending more time on this function, on deliberation. So that is that. Then next is parliamentary panel questions dilution of labor laws. So parliamentary committee on labor has written to state governments demanding an explanation on dilution of labor laws during the ongoing COVID-19 pandemic. So BJP ruled states like MP, UP and Gujarat have modified labor laws to attract investment and restart economy. So parliamentary committee on labor chaired by BJD leader Biju Janata Dal leader has written to states questioning on this. Even Punjab, Himachal Pradesh, and Gujarat have amended their Factories Act and increased the work hours from 8 to 12 hours a day or 72 hours per week. So already labor laws codification was being done, like existing 44 labor laws were proposed to be codified into four codes, and one of them, code on wages bill, has been cleared, while other three are pending in Lok Sabha. So labor laws are pending, codification of labor laws, while presently what we are seeing is relaxation of these labor laws. And 10 central trade unions are considering approaching the International Labor Organization against this move of the states. The next is defense think tank renamed unilaterally. So several members of executive council of the renamed Manohar Parrikar Institute for Defense Studies and Analysis have said, have spoken to the defense minister Rajnath Singh, saying that they should have been consulted before the institution was named. So institute was renamed in February 2020 after the late defense minister and BJP leader Manohar Parrikar. So the executive council members say that any change in nomenclature of the institute calls for proposal to be cleared by the general body, because such decision making affects the established identity of the institute and casts a shadow on its autonomy too. So they said, we do not refute and respect the contribution of former defense minister Manohar Parrikar, but setting such a precedent and politicizing defense related institute cannot be approved. So Institute of Defense Studies and Analysis was set up in 1965 and has evolved to become the most famous think tank of strategic affairs community in India over the years. The next is work on Museum of PMs to begin. So Central Public Works Department has initiated the process for the Museum on Prime Ministers of India work, which is a museum proposed on Teen Murti Estate, which is the former residence of late Prime Minister Jawaharlal Nehru in Delhi. It houses the Nehru Memorial Museum and Library. So Prime Minister Narendra Modi said that this should be a museum, there should be a museum for all Prime Ministers of the country, not just the first Prime Minister. So Central Public Works, he had already laid the foundation for Museum of Prime Ministers of India, and Central Public Works Department, which is agency under the Ministry of Housing and Urban Affairs, is going to execute this project of the Museum of Prime Ministers of India, and it has floated a tender presently for contractors to finish the project in 6 months for external development and lighting work, which will cost 10.3 crore rupees. So this is the proposal for national, this is Nehru Memorial Museum and Library Society. It floats proposal to revamp Nehru Museum, and proposal for more contemporary museum of governance has sparked controversy. And then in 2017, Prime Minister called for a museum of all Prime Ministers of the country. And in 2018, dissenting views came, but Nehru Memorial Museum and Library cleared this proposal. And it's proposed that at the Teen Murti Estate itself, separate from the existing Nehru Museum, another Museum of Prime Ministers would be established. In October 2018, Prime Minister Narendra Modi laid the foundation stone for this new museum. The work is being done presently for this. A tender has been initiated. Then next is decision on power project deferred. So Forest Advisory Committee, which is the apex body of Environment Ministry, tasked with deciding whether forest land can be diverted for industrial projects, has once again deferred its decision on controversial 3,097 megawatt Italian hydropower project in Arunachal Pradesh, Dibang Valley. So the project has been delayed for over 6 years now because it requires diverting 1,165 hectares of forest in the rich region of biodiversity in the Dibang Valley in Arunachal Pradesh. So it was in 2015, FAC had ruled that even the environment impact assessment commissioned by the power company was not properly done. It did not properly account for environment impact of the project. It recommended that this should be done, EIA, environment impact assessment should be done by internationally credible institute and over multiple seasons to record the region's ecological constitution. It had also recommended, Forest Advisory Committee recommended, National Tiger Conservation Authority to be consulted because tigers have been sighted in the region. But then it is seen that none of the recommendations had been complied with. A wildlife assessment was done by Wildlife Institute of India, but this is an autonomous body funded by Environment Ministry. So FAC says the recommendations have not been complied with, and again it has deferred its decision for approving this hydropower project. You can see it will result in destruction of 270,000 trees in the Dibang Valley. Then next is India may miss nutrition targets. So India is among 88 countries that are likely to miss global nutrition targets by 2025, according to Global Nutrition Report of 2020. So country has the highest rates of domestic inequalities also in malnutrition. We'll see how. So World Health Assembly in 2012 had identified this under World Health Organization. We just discussed World Health Assembly. India is going to chair it now. So in 2012, it had decided and identified 6 nutrition targets for maternal, infant and young child nutrition to be met by 2025. But then they said 88 countries are going to miss these targets by 2025 and India is one of them. So what were these targets? You can see are reduce stunting by 40% in children under 5, reduce prevalence of anemia by 50% among women in the age group of 19 to 49, ensure 30% reduction in low birth weight and no increase in childhood overweight too. Increase the rate of exclusive breastfeeding in the first 6 months up to at least 50%, and reduce and maintain childhood wasting to less than 5%. So these were the targets set, and these are to be achieved, but it is seen that some countries will be lagging. And India is identified amongst the 3 worst countries, along with Nigeria and Indonesia, for steep within-country disparities on stunting. So you can see stunting level in UP is said to be over 40%. And among individuals in the lowest income groups, it is more than double of those in the highest income groups. So stunting prevalence, huge variation is seen. And it is said to be 10% higher in rural areas as compared to urban areas. So this is there. Also in overweight and obesity, it is seen nearly double number of women are obese than men. So these are within the country disparities. Then next is Wuhan to test entire population after new virus cluster emerges. So Wuhan plans to conduct COVID-19 tests on the Chinese city's entire population because new cases have emerged for the first time in weeks after the lockdown was also ended. The city reopened after 76 days lockdown on April 8th. And now you can see on May 12th, we are seeing new cases emerging and the entire population is proposed to be tested. Next is Glenmark initiates phase 3 clinical trial for favipiravir in India. So we had seen earlier also about favipiravir. It is a generic version of Avigan, which is a drug for treating flu. Of a Japanese company, Fujifilm Toyama Chemical Limited, which is a subsidiary of Fujifilm Corporation. So it has been approved in Japan for treatment of novel coronavirus infection. And Glenmark is using the generic version of this and has initiated clinical trials. It has initiated now phase 3 of clinical trials. India's drug regulator, Drug Controller General of India, has approved for this. The approval has been given for this to Glenmark. So once ready, it would be released, commercialized and released in the market under the brand name Fabiflu. So this is one of the treatments for COVID-19. What is phase 3 clinical trial? You can see the all phases are shown. So first preclinical trial is exploring if and how a new drug may work. And then once drug is approved for human testing, phase 1 is exploring the safety and dosing of the drug, that how much, whether the drug is safe and what dose should be given. Then phase 2 clinical trial is exploring the effectiveness of the drug. So first safety, then effectiveness. And phase 3 is exploring the safety and effectiveness compared to currently available treatments or comparative studies. So that is phase 3 clinical trial. So you should know that. And then the FDA of USA approves. So a review is sent for a review, which will be used to confirm safety and effectiveness of the drug. And once the drug is approved, as such, means it is Food and Drug Administration. So once it is approved, then phase 4 would be there of evaluating the drug over time in large number of patients. So that's how the clinical trial process is conducted and generally takes 5 to 15 years. But then special cases can result in speeding up the process too. And the last news is GI tag for Sohrai Khovar painting, Telai Rumal. So, Jharkhand's Sohrai Khovar painting and Telangana's Telai Rumal have been given geographical indication, GI tag, by Geographical Indications Registry headquartered in Chennai. So, this Sohrai Khovar painting of Jharkhand, it's a traditional and ritualistic mural art practiced by local tribal women during local harvest. And that is Sohrai, and Khovar is used during marriage seasons. They use local naturally available soils of different colors as such. And the style is also comprising of lines, dots, animal figures, and plants, and even religious iconography, religious symbols. So in recent years, it is said Sohrai Khowar paintings have also been found on walls of important public places in Jharkhand, such as Birsa Munda Airport in Ranchi and Hazaribagh, Tata Nagar Railway Station, etc. And regarding the second product of Telangana, Telai Rumal. Telai Rumal cloth involves intricate handmade work with cotton loom. So it has designs and motifs in three particular colors, that is red, black, and white. So this Telai Rumal can only be created using traditional handloom process and not by any other mechanical means, because the quality of Rumal would be lost there. And it has been practiced since the Nizam's times in Puttapakkam, which is a small backward village of Telangana. So it has been patronized by rich Muslim families and Nizams. And it was worn as a veil even by princesses of the Nizam of Hyderabad. And also as turban cloth by urbans and Middle East. These are Telai Rumals. So this is, you can see, Birsa Murda Airport in Ranchi, where you can see the painting Sohrai Khowar. So this painting is done a day after Diwali for celebrating a good harvest and the Lakshmi Puja. That is Sohrai, and Khowar painting is done in the bride's house where the marriage rites are performed. And regarding Telai Rumal, you can see the term Telai is actually tel, meaning oil. So this name is given to this craft because some quantity of oil is used to prepare yarn for ikat weaving. And clay and wax wrapping is used. The finished yarn is readied on which weaver can design an exact pattern before it's dipped in a dye. And there are three major colors used, which are red, white, and black. So it uses geometric or floral motifs. These are Telai Rumals. So that is it. Thank you.